So we're going to be starting to talk about applications of integration. Oftentimes when people hear the word integration, they think area. Because when we introduce integration, we oftentimes do it by thinking about it in terms of area. But actually, integration is for so much more. You see, integrations are for answering the question, how much is there? So whenever you see a problem that asks, what is the total? How much is there? You know you're working with some kind of an integration problem. And there's lots of questions that you can ask. What is the total area? It's just one of them. You could say, what is the total volume? What is the total length? Or you can say, how about, what is the total mass? Or maybe, what's the inertia? Which is another topic in physics. There's all sorts of questions. Even you can go into finance and you say, well, what's the total amount of money in my investments? Well, that's actually an integration type question. Anything that involves adding things up. So let's talk about the general framework for applications, because as we go through over the course of the next several topics, we're going to see this coming up over and over and over again. So if we have it in mind what it is, then we can say, aha, it's just one general framework, and we just have to sort of slot the different ideas into place. All right, so here we go. So the idea is that we're going to break what we are looking for into small, easy to approximate pieces. Now, why? Well, because they're easy to approximate. You see, oftentimes what we're looking for is something which is complicated if we take it as a whole, but we break it up into smaller parts. Now, we say, okay, look, what happens with each part? Well, we give a good approximation for it. And it's our ability to give a good approximation that really determines how do you break things up. Because if you can't approximate what you've broken up, it's a terrible choice to how you break things up. But if you can get a good approximation, it's beautiful. Beautiful. All right, so we broke things up. We got a good approximation for each part. And now we add them all together. And you say, well, okay, that makes sense. If I take a problem and I break into small parts and I know the answer for each part, if I add it back together, that's the total. Now, you might say, where's the catch? Well, the catch is that when we were doing our approximation, it means that we're off a little bit in each part. But the idea here is that when we have our parts getting smaller and smaller, our error gets smaller and smaller. Not just our individual error, so in other words, our error for each piece, but our total error. And therefore, in the limit, in other words, as things get smaller and smaller, see, anytime you see something like closer and closer or smaller and smaller, there's really a limit involved. So in our limit, our sum, that's what's represented here by this sigma, sum over here, this subscript just says summing over all our parts. And then we have the contribution from each part. And there's a small piece here, this delta xi says, look, somehow how you broke things into small parts, that small change in your input should show up somewhere in a natural way. Well, this becomes an integral because integration is all about addition. The function that we're integrating and this small change becomes our dx. So that's the basic idea. So let's just see one quick example that we already are familiar with, and that is area. You see area, what do? Well, suppose I'm looking for the area between these two curves. So I have this curve g of x on the bottom and this curve f of x on the top. Well, what can I do? The answer is I say, all right, I can break things into these small little rectangles. And I say, all right, now, lo and behold, I can get a good approximation for any single rectangle. What I do is I say, let's look at the height. So here's our height. It's from the top curve to the bottom curve. And then we'll multiply it by our delta xi, which is our width. So now I have a height and a width multiplying together, which means what do I have? I have an area. Aha! So what we're really doing here is we're really saying, look, let's add up a little piece of area. Now, of course, the one little piece is not the whole thing. So we have to, of course, split into lots of little pieces. So there's all these little parts, each one we're adding up. So there's always an error. But again, as we get smaller and smaller slices, our error gets smaller and smaller, and therefore, in the limit, it will go away. So that is how we get our area. Our top function minus our bottom function times our little dx, our width. Now, one of the things I recommend, and I'm going to keep saying this over and over again, so I'll say it now, because it's good to start getting it into our head. When you're memorizing these formulas, don't always memorize like, okay, I have this function minus this function, there's a square involved. No, memorize what things represent. You see, if we understand what things represent, we have a much better chance of being able to adapt so that if we modify our setting in a small way, we're fine. We can adapt. Whereas if you try to memorize too many formulas, that's just sort of like, oh, I square this, I add that, then you start to lose what things represent. And then you're not adaptable, and you want to be adaptable. So the way I remember area is it's a height and a width. I multiply them together and I add it up. And so you'll see that again and again. Every time we go into an application, we'll say, well, this part represents this part represents that. And of course, the integral says we add everything up, and that's the total. All right, well, we're going to be going through lots of applications, so it's good to have this mindset. Break things into parts, figure out what's happening with each part, add it all together, and there we are. That's the answer. Okay, well, time to begin.